Oh. So good afternoon, everyone. We are here in a way to learn together possibilities of using Python, coding in Python in astronomical context. And we are going to start with very simple positional astronomy context. And so we are looking at, let's say, the sky, and we are going to talk a little bit about coordinates in the sky. What are these different coordinates? We are going to talk a little bit about perhaps one particular problem to do with coordinates in the sky, and that is arising from one very recent event which created a lot of excitement. There was a conjunction between Jupiter and Saturn a while ago, and it created so much of excitement. And we actually have quite a number of you students who have participated in the Samantha Chandrasekhar challenge of measuring this angle between Jupiter and Saturn as it was changing using cross staff, and you all made your own cross staffs and so on. Use this simple geometrical equation to make this measurement. Not all of you, because I think there are quite a large number of school students who are present here who have maybe just come in when we said that we will do this code camp in positional astronomy. So we have probably a very mixed kind of a group. And in this mixed group, there are perhaps some very young school students and who got excited about possibility of coding and came in. And probably there are some college students who have already done some coding. Somebody says no voice. Is it all right now? Are you able to hear me? Just please message that. And now use the chat box, essentially, maybe just to go along with what I'm saying and giving me some answers or putting your questions and so on. And what we are going to do is have some discussions of positional astronomy context, and followed with some very preliminary kind of just a kind of a plug for Python, meaning why is it that we want to use Python. And if possible, if time permits, we will try and maybe make our very first Hello World program. And maybe if we move forward from that, we may even try and do a plot or two. But we will see as we go. We will see. What is it that we are going to do? Before we do anything further, all right, so, but as far as my network does seem to be quite good. So I don't know if the voice breaking is from my end or from other end also. Somebody says my voice is breaking. Okay, the first and foremost thing, which I was just wanting to let all of you know, perhaps most of you are aware of it, and most of you are already in this group. There is this group, WhatsApp group, because following today's discussion, all other further discussions.
Voice is fine. I'm listening. It's clear. Very clear.
All other discussions are going to be in this WhatsApp group. But it will also be kind of, we will have sessions, online sessions like this time to time. And I think next Tuesday and Wednesday, we are going to have some sessions Saurabh will be taking using online Jupyter notebooks. One thing I wanted to mention, perhaps I will do that after I finish some preliminary discussions on positional astronomy. Many of you may be aware of this concept, but please be patient. And I'm not going into very many nitty gritties today, because not all of you may want to do coding in the context of serious positional astronomy. Maybe some of you may just want to look at some data, plot it. Or maybe some of you may want to go a little serious into actually some astronomy explorations and so on. So I don't know what context you actually may want to do this coding in. We took up as an example some very simple positional astronomy context. And so where we are going, we are going to discuss this further in the WhatsApp group. Now, there was this very exciting event which happened recently, and more excitements are going to come. There are a few more such conjunctions. Of course, the Jupiter-Saturn conjunction is passed us by. These conjunctions keep happening, but there are some conjunctions ahead of us which have to do with Mars, Venus, and these fellows, and so on. And surprisingly, this year, many of these conjunctions happen to be when they are so close that they can be seen through one telescope view. So that's why the conjunction seems to be an exciting aspect, and maybe we get started with that. So in that context, we may want to know what was this angle between Jupiter and Saturn, and it has been changing, and actually there is a way we could actually find out theoretically what should be this angle. And those of you who participated in the Saman Chandrasekhar challenge may recall this hockey stick kind of a diagram, and this was plotted just in Excel, but the theoretical data was obtained through NASA ephemerides, and those also are things which we are going to look at. Because what we want to know is data about positions of these objects, positions of maybe the star or a planet or the sun in the sky. And from that, with the sun, for instance, we actually tell the time. Sun's motion in the sky becomes a little more complex than the stellar motions, because Earth itself is going around the sun, and so on. So it is all of these complexities, and not all of them, we are going to discuss today. Today it will be just a kind of a flavor of the kind of data which may be there, and a little bit of a flavor about how we may be using Python to do some coding for this. So now, let me, I think, get started with Stellarium, which probably every one of you have used, right? If not, download it. And I think there may be many school students who have joined us. And okay, so I should, this is not a good view, good kind of a view for Stellarium. I actually cheated here. Let me remove for now all the grids in Stellarium, and let me bring back the solar system objects. Let me bring back the ground. Let me bring back the atmosphere, and so there we have, and that tells us this is what we start with, right? When we are using Stellarium, those of you who have used it already, I mean, please ignore many of the things which I'm saying. Those of you who have not used it, I hope you have downloaded and get started using it, and in the group, people will give you some help. So we take a look at objects in the sky, where they are, and so on. That is what is the positional astronomy about, where objects are in the sky. So one way the only thing which I am a little I have to apologize about is that these in Stellarium, the colors of these grids, etc., it's not good. But unfortunately, I have no other, I am not able to share our planetarium software visuals, which would be wonderful. For now, I'm just using Stellarium. Great. I hope you are able, you can message me if you are not able to see. Yeah, okay, someone wants to know web version also fine. Yeah, web version can be used too. Because right now, we are not using Stellarium very heavily. We are only just trying to see these coordinates using Stellarium. No more than that. Okay, so use any of those versions that you like, and I have given these. So if you want to know, you can just use the help on the side and go to the markings and click on the azimuth grid, and you have the grid, which is the altitude azimuth grid. Now, what is this? So let me tell you what this is. Many of you may be well aware what this is, but we think of whatever is in the sky from the perspective of positional astronomy as something on top of half a football on our head, or the other half is the other side, of course. It means that the distances along the line of sight we are ignoring, and we are thinking that everything is like on half a football or a full football, right? And then it is rotating, and so on. So the distance factor is gone. So if you have done spherical trigonometry, you will know then that the coordinates then needed are going to be theta phi. R theta phi would be the kind of coordinate which will define your kind of when you are making your spherical coordinate system. In that, R is this, we are putting it to be the same for all of them. Actually, astronomy will not forgive you. Modern astronomy will not forgive you. And even from ancient time onwards, one knew that the distances to different objects is different. But we are dropping that part and treating as if everything is on at one radius. And so we have two angles. So the two angles in a local kind of a framework are what are called altitude and azimuth. And if you are able to see this clearly, you will see that there is kind of at the center, there is this zenith, and then you are dividing into kind of 360 degrees, north, south, east, west, and 0 to 90 degrees from zenith to anywhere in the horizon. So these divisions are the altitude and azimuth. So you take any object in the sky, drop a perpendicular from that object to the horizon where earth meets the sky, and the angle to that object and between a ray to that object in the horizon, that is the altitude. And take the point P where the we have dropped the perpendicular, start from the direction north and move eastwards till you come to this, and this horizontal angle is the azimuth. These are local coordinates. And okay, so those of you who have not got stellarium, don't worry, you can get it in time. Stellarium part of it going along, you can do Aram Sir. Be sure you join in the programming parts of it. Stellarium part is going to be over very soon. Okay, so this is the altitude and azimuth. And this is one way of doing some coordinates. On the other hand, you may also all right, I think now I will share a presentation I had where there are a couple of pages. Oh, for some reason I'm not able to share this presentation. Just give me a second. I have this couple of slides in this. All right. For some reason, I'm not able to share that. Okay, don't worry. We'll stick to stellarium for now. And okay, I will instead use this. So where I don't have that, I will use this. So you are standing somewhere on this, and you can have altitude azimuth coordinates. However, when you're standing on different paths, the altitude azimuth coordinates are going to change. So suppose you think of the center of the earth and think of a coordinate system from the center of the earth. And I think if I am able to share that slide, it would be useful. So take the center of the earth and take the equator of the earth. Okay, take the equator of the earth. Since I'm not able to share that slide, I'm going to use some jugaad. Take the equator of the earth and throw it up into the sky, and this is the celestial equator, and so this is one of our centers of the coordinate systems, one of the central axes for our coordinate system. You can think of, you know, perpendicular to the equator. So if you go to the north of the equator and south of the equator, so just like, you know, like you have our globe. So you just similarly, our latitude, similar to our latitude, longitude, you throw it out into the globe. And so you may have coordinates. But for these coordinates, you need a central one point of reference on this equator. Where will that point of reference come from? There is another arc. And this arc is the annual apparent path of the sun. This is called the ecliptic. So this arc then crosses the equator in two points. So these two points actually are what are called the equinoxes. So if this is the ecliptic, the sun is going around, this is the equator, or this is the ecliptic, let's say this is the equator. Then sun, when it is here at the extreme points, it is on the solstices, summer solstice or winter solstice and so on. And when it is on these two points, it is the equinox. So these two equinox points in the sky, two points in the sky, are very important for this particular setup. Wherein, you know, like you start with the March equinox point. Start with the March equinox point. And so this is your zero. And you go along the equator. So 0 to 24 hours are defined along the equator. So these coordinates are called right ascension. And so this entire 360 degree is divided into 24 hours of earth spin movement. So you have 24 hours of right ascension. And north of the equator and south of the equator, you have the declination. So it can be 0 to plus 90, 0 to minus 90. So these will then define, like around the earth, you just have another concentric sphere and treat that as your celestial sphere. And on that sphere, you will have coordinates which are the right ascension and declination. And you can kind of relate these with a few other coordinates, which maybe we will talk about when we come down to the details. But essentially, I just wanted to mention to you, one other set of coordinates also I want to mention. But how we are actually going to calculate, let's say, find from azimuth and altitude, how are we going to go to the other coordinates, and how time comes in, what is called the sidereal time, and what is called the hour angle, etc., etc. Maybe when we are going into more details, we will go there. I just wanted to mention to you that there are these. Okay, we also had a look at stellarium, right? So, since we talked of the right ascension and declination, let us put those coordinates in. So, equatorial grid, and I put that. And so, maybe if we keep both, it gets a little confusing. So, let me, for a while, just take a look at it, and then I'll remove the, see, there is the altitude azimuth grid here, and there is the right ascension and declination grid here. And you can see that the poles are different. The poles for altitude azimuth is your overhead point. And the pole for the right ascension declination is where the north celestial pole is. Maybe let me remove the local one. Then you can probably see this grid more comfortably. This is the north pole. You have these. And let's if we move the time, you can see that you have this grid defined. All right. So, okay. For some reason, actually the grid, these are fixed to the grid, these fellows. Okay, that comes out very nicely in our planetarium software. I'll try and use it sometime. But one other coordinate I wanted to mention, and that is, in addition, we need to know this a little bit to know about conjunctions. And, okay, all right. So you have the celestial equator and you have the ecliptic, right? So when you have these two, we talked of coordinates. For those of you from school and from younger classes, it's like I hope you have started drawing graphs. That is the minimum which would be required to do anything here. So we need kind of coordinate systems to draw these graphs, and these graph kind of coordinate we have are on a sphere, and we are looking at the surface of the sphere, and therefore we have these complex kind of coordinates. So as we go along and maybe do some more problems with this, perhaps you will become more comfortable with it. So you have this equator, right, celestial equator. So we had angles 0 to 24 degree along this, and we have 0 to 90, 0 to minus 90 perpendicular to this. Now think of coordinates along this, and there will be a pole of this also. There is a pole which is for the equator, the pole is where we have the north celestial pole. But for the ecliptic, there is a kind of a pole which shifts in the sky. So you can have coordinates along the ecliptic angle and perpendicular to that. These are called ecliptic latitude and longitude. And essentially, the sun is along the ecliptic. Most of the planet, all the solar system bodies spiral around this. So looking at their ecliptic coordinates is of use, particularly for us to know about conjunctions. So let me come back to the conjunctions. So, if there are some questions about people facing problems with the software, etc., as I see some of you are helping the others, that is good. Now, coming back to the conjunction, for instance, there was this kind of a graph which was drawn, which is to do with how the angle between Jupiter and Saturn is varying. How are we going to get this angle, and also what defines a conjunction? What defines a conjunction is, you see, when, let's look at this one, that figure which I have, that will help us. Yes, as these planets are going around the sun, some planets are slower, some are faster, the inner ones are slower, outer ones are faster. There will always come times when one of the planets overtakes the other. You can see that. These keep happening. So, at such an instance, actually, we have the ecliptic. If you want to mathematically say when is the conjunction taking place, if you look at their ecliptic, ecliptic longitudes, they'll keep varying, and at one point they'll be equal. That is the conjunction. So we have to learn to look up these kind of coordinates. Please don't get worried if there are too many of these things being talked about and you are not familiar with these. This is just to give a kind of a flavor that at the basic positional astronomy level, what are the kind of data that we may be looking at. We may also be looking at finding out these angles. We also want to do, and some of you have done this, but using different kind of software, is these angles were measured and you plotted these angles, and this is a graph some of you have submitted, and from this you are actually trying to extrapolate and obtain the value for a particular date. This the Samantha Challenge students have done it. So this is other kind of coding context that we will need. We will need very much, and here right now to begin with, we will only do linear kind of a thing, where we have some numbers, we have obtained some numbers, and they seem to be showing some kind of, you know, linear pattern, and we want to know a number ahead of us or behind us, where we think it is linear like this. So we are going to use this coding context to find out how to do that. We may also go ahead and try to find out about, there is something called the equation of time. When we want to do sundial measurements, sun, the way it moves, apparently moves in the sky. So sometimes it moves, appears to move faster, sometimes slower, compared to some kind of a mean sun, which would be kind of doing equal 24 hours kind of changes. So such equations of time, knowing the parameters of Earth, we may be able to calculate and draw, I mean, just plot these. So these are the kind of things we would want to do in basic positional astronomy context. And these equations of time, actually, as years change, small changes in this also happen. So we may also want to find out the basic, basically how we are going to do this and try to plot these kinds of equations of state. These are some contexts in which we are going to be doing these coding. I'll also show you how we are going to go and get some of the data. Some quantities, actually, you can just, the altitude, azimuth, right ascension, declination I've talked about. We can actually go to stellarium to begin with, and look up these objects. Let's remove all these things and just look. Let's look up the objects that we know in the sky. There is Arcturus, Swati, and you all perhaps know, if you click on it, a whole lot of information about it comes on the side, and it gives you some of the positional astronomy data. So, of course, the altitude and azimuth, unless you stop the time, it's going to keep changing, altitude and azimuth. But, so you can see that altitude and azimuth is given here, right ascension and declination are given here. Altitude and azimuth will keep changing, right ascension and declination will it won't change now over the next few days, that when we are doing this code camp, much longer times it changes. It gives you a whole lot of information. So you could, if you like, pick up some of this information and may want to do some positional astronomy. Like, for instance, you may take take any star, you change your time. Oh, it didn't go to process. Take a star. Why is it not showing the star? All right. You go to a star. And then you do change the time and see how its altitude azimuth are changing. You can see that altitude azimuth are changing here. So you may want to do that. So this also, the stellarium itself will give you some data that for you to kind of just try to do a few for positional astronomy kind of data to get. But before we do all of this, we have to actually, of course, go very step by step to figure out how we are going to put any of this kind of information that we have into a program. Maybe some of you have done some programming. Yeah, all right. Okay, thanks, Amritanshu, for clarifying about that. All right. And okay, thanks. I mean, all of you do pitch in because we have a mixed group, right? Some of you know all of this. Some of you have no idea what I'm talking about. So sometimes I try to go too slow and sometimes maybe a little fast. So you all fill in. That's good. And now, yeah, I didn't give the east-west part of it. Okay. So where was I? I was saying that we have talked about some of the contexts in which we may be able to get either a theoretical equation or a bunch of numbers. First thing we want to do is plot either this theoretical equation or these bunch of numbers. And many of you have already done it using various kinds of coding contexts. But in this now, what we are planning to do is just do these very simple things. Plot your data, what you have already done, plot it now in Python. Some of you have already done this. And those of you who have not done this, just pick up any context where you will get some numbers and plot this. Even this graph, etc., etc. All these graphs we are going to plot. So before that, we will need to learn some basics of Python. But before we come to that, there is one more thing I want to share. And that is, okay, I'll need to stop sharing this. Oh, I have too many tabs open in my system. I want to show you the NASA ephemeris data, how you are going to get it. Once again, many of you may be well aware. And some of the things that we are going to do are going to be essentially positional astronomy data. Data like altitude, azimuth, right ascension. I told you that you can pull it out of stellarium. But when you pull it out of stellarium, you have to one by one, you have to pick it up. It's fun. Initially, you can do that. But you can actually get tabulated values of this. And we want to learn maybe how to get these tabulated values and then how to plot. And maybe from that deduce that a conjunction is happening. That is what our first exercise is going to be. And maybe, after today's preliminaries, we'll get started working on this in the WhatsApp group. So to go through this horizon, in Google, you just type NASA horizons or horizon web interface or something like that, you will come across this. See, this is solar system data, JPL NASA. All right. So what you do here, the body that you want. Here, for instance, it says the body is Saturn. It says the location is geocentric. So maybe I want to know for Delhi. Okay, so what I can do here is, enter this. And there is various formats in which this is to be done. Yeah, okay, this is, I think, one way I was entering. Longitude, 77 degree, 1359, and latitude. And I think the altitude is also 220, but it's in meters. And the body ID for the Earth is 399, if I remember. So this is the preliminary information that you will have to give to actually locate yourself on the Earth. Of course, you can go to the center of the Earth also in this. But you have located yourself on the Earth. And you also may want to know for some particular time. So actually, it's not Saturn I'm going to look at. I think I'd like to maybe look at Venus or Mars and then figure out what's happening to them. Where are we here? This is when I was doing these calculations for the great conjunction of Jupiter Saturn. Okay, maybe we take it from 1st January. All right, so I'll tell you what, let's go a little into February. And today is what? Today, I don't know what it is, but 20 maybe. Let's go up to. Okay, something like this. All right. So it's going to do in step sizes. You try to get data like this. And this is what, but the more difficult, more complexities will come here. Here, there is this host of things that you can choose from. And I hope this is visible to everyone. Yeah. So are there any comments, questions? Okay. Now, who is this? Please don't post unnecessary comments, all right, because that's going to make it difficult for me to see necessary comments. All right, so where were we? So we try to find out some, like, look at this RA index means the right ascension declination. Altitude azimuth, actually it is given like this, AZ EL is the altitude azimuth and so on. So suppose we just want to know where these objects are. Let's not worry too much about any of these things. But because it's a complex thing, I would just like to discuss a little bit, and perhaps as we go and do more work, we will. So just use this apparent azimuth and elevation. That's what we are using. Well, we use apparent because actually, you know, refraction effects change it slightly. So we say we want this. And if we take it for Saturn, okay, we can try this. Just remember though, the time given here always is going to be GMT. So UT, as it is called. So we have to add 5.5 hours to this. Oh, all right. Here, actually, it is giving for one specific time. Yeah, in fact, some of you may Remember when I had made this graph, I had used this, and it is giving to midnight of GMT as of now, because I have used one day each day. Actually, elevation azimuth for each day doesn't make so much sense. If I was, I would need to actually take, let's say, for a particular day. And so this is 20, right? So let me do till 21 and let me do in minutes. Use this and then generate the ephemeris again. And then it is going to show us the altitude azimuth for Saturn as it is changing. So if you see elevation negative, it means Saturn is set. And if you see the elevation too low, as it is now, see Saturn is not visible in the sky, all these negative ones. This is the azimuth. Remember the azimuth that we did? And this is the elevation. When it gets to positive is when Saturn can be seen. But the time, 225, you have to add 5.5 hours to this, because this gives in UT. So this is how we can actually get, and I would like to do one more thing here. One more thing I have to show you. And for that, again, I should go back to. Oh, yeah. This is fine. I maybe should go back to days. So this is going 20th January, 21st February, and we are doing this. But I'm going to change the quantities. Change the quantities to, where is this? I'm looking for not elongation. Ecliptic coordinates. Where are the ecliptic coordinates? Heliocentric. Well, we want observer defined. Observer ecliptic longitude and latitude. We take this, and this says that it gets. So, okay, let's just take this, and we are going to get these values. Ecliptic longitude and latitude. Please don't worry about this fact, this being all so dry and a lot of numbers and so on. But it's the numbers which are finally going to tell us where are things in the sky. So this is the ecliptic longitude, ecliptic latitude. And it just, you know, ecliptic latitude will be quite close for solar system objects, because they're all close to the sun in the sky, relatively speaking. The longitude, of course, will keep changing. And we will talk more about this a little later. But this is the data. You want to pull out this kind of data. This is the crux of it. You want to pull out this kind of data. Let us say for Mars and for Venus, you are going to pull out this kind of data. And when you pull out this kind of data, you want to run this through a code. And you want to make the code check. When is it maybe the ecliptic longitude is coinciding? When is it that they are going? What is the changing angle? Even the changing angle, for instance. All right. What is it? Which website? Okay. The website is you. This is the one. Solar System Data, JPL, NASA, GOE. You just type in Google NASA Horizon Ephemeris or something. Then you will go there. Okay. Then there was one other thing I wanted to tell you. Now, once you get not this. Ecliptic latitude, longitude, but rather, okay, maybe I should show that also. Let's go back and calculate this one, the right ascension and declination. Let's leave this one and calculate this. So once you get this, you can actually get this for the two planets that you want. The right ascension and the declination. Remember, we talked about right ascension and declination. So you can get these values. And when you get these values, you can do one more thing. You can do a calculation about the angle between them. And many of you did this when you did the Samantha Chandrasekhar challenge. And oh, looks like I haven't put up that image. Let me just put that one which shows the angular value. This one does. So I'll just flash that equation to you. We may do, those of you who are following these nitty-gritties, we will have further discussions in the WhatsApp group. But though this may look a little complicated, but it isn't all that much if you just sit down and patiently do bit by bit, one by one. And what happens here is this is the right ascension of a star, another star. This is the declination of a star and another star. That's what you need. Right ascension and declination. And you get them from here. You get them from here, right? So you have to use this to find out the changing angle, let's say, between two objects. This is just a starting exercise that we want to do. Now, as we go and start listening to the Python talks, we will see that this is so powerful. And we are perhaps, what we are doing is using a bulldozer to crack a peanut when we are actually doing this job. When we are doing this job, what we are doing is a very powerful source we are using. And using that powerful source, we are doing a very simple thing here. But that is how we have to start, right? So what I am hoping that out of this this session in the beginning, these sessions, what we are going to do is run towards doing making maybe one simple theoretical graph in connection with positional astronomy to begin with, and one simple graph with respect to data. And this is how we will get started with our okay, somebody wants to know what is angular separation. So let's say you have in the sky, suppose you are, I mean, a few days back, a month back, you could easily see Jupiter and Saturn in the evening sky. Now you have to go to the morning sky after some time and you'll see these planets again. Two planets are there, Mars and Venus. Take Mars and draw a line towards your eye. Take Venus and draw a line towards your eye. So the angle that this line makes, this is the angular separation between Mars and Jupiter. And knowing a little bit of positional astronomy will tell you how theoretically you could actually calculate it. And those of you who have participated, let me just because there was a question asking what is angular separation. There is a beautiful medieval instrument called a crossstaff. The crossstaff is just that you have a stick, two sticks. And there are many of you who are there who have done this, and maybe you could have some discussions in the group telling those people who have not done it. You make a simple construction like this, two sticks, and you should be able to kind of move either this position here or the slats here, and you line it up. See, this was my observation when I was observing. Of course, this is not the exact observed position, but you see these two slats, you line them up. You can move them back and forth, and you see the edge here, this edge should be on the two stars. So we were doing it for Jupiter and Saturn. Now in early mornings, you can do it for Mars, Venus, or those fellows who are coming in for conjunction, and they'll be moving away from conjunction later. So maybe then you can do it better, and so on. So this exercise, many of you have already done. So maybe now you want to move to the computing aspects of it. But those who have not done, I would say that do this. It has been great fun doing this, and I was also doing it with all the students who are doing it. And I'm also trying to learn Python along with you and try to move to doing a little bit of simple analysis like this. And then, because it's a very powerful tool, if you get into it, there are many things you can do. Whatever field you go in, you will find that there are applications that you can put that. So perhaps this will be enough as a preliminary discussion for the positional astronomy context. Let me just see if I've left out anything which I would have had like to mention. So there, basically, conjunction was one context, and sundial, I did flash this equation, and just let me just mention this one other point also. The reason that such a difference comes between the real sun and a kind of a mean sun, there are two aspects. Earth spin is giving us our day and night. So Earth is spinning, and that is giving us our day and night. Earth is also going around the sun. When it is going around the sun, the orbit is elliptical. Not very elliptical, but a little bit elliptical. And this makes, you know, like we can still see that because of this, the movement that we see in the sky of the sun is getting affected by this. Not so much, but a little bit. More effect comes from the fact that this axis of rotation of Earth is tilted with respect to the plane in which Earth is going around the sun. These two combination, and now if I probably share one more Chrome tab, let me see if I have it there. Yeah, I think I have this. This is Wikipedia only, and you can see that this is the, it gives a very nice, here. Are you able to see this? Let me just check in the studio, are you just seeing it? Yeah. So this is because of the fact that you have a little bit elliptical orbit, some change which comes about between a real sun and a mean sun. And then the effect which comes about from the fact that Earth's axis of rotation is tilted with respect to plane. And you have the combined effect, which is actually the equation of time. And this is the reason also why if we were to, let's say, image the sun at one point, and every 15 days, let's say, you keep taking image, keep all your setups the same, and keep imaging the sun and add all of these, you get a kind of a figure eight. And now in this digital era, Ajay Talwar is now doing it. This kind, and he's also including Ajay Talwar, a senior amateur astronomer, he's also including one solar eclipse image in this NLMR. Now, if you don't have those kind of advanced photography skills, you can actually get a feel for an NLMR by putting a kind of a cricket wicket down on the ground. Make sure that it is absolutely vertical, the floor is absolutely flat, and at one specific time mark the end of the shadow of that cricket wicket. And so maybe 15 days later again, but it has to be the same time. So then, you know, like this is showing us the difference between a clock time and the sundial time, and the complexity is coming about just from these two facts. So okay, these are the kind of backgrounds in which I wanted to say that we will do our coding context. And so let me just get back to this. And now we are going to move on. Let me just check whether there are any positional astronomy questions. All right, okay, good. Those of you who are answering, thank you. So I think that is fine. So these are some of the positional astronomy contexts in which we were thinking that we are going to do Python coding. And as I was saying, I am going to do the learning along with you. All right, so Karma, if you have not understood, could you ask specific questions? Which part you have understood, which part you have not understood? Let me just briefly just summarize. What we are trying to do is learn coding, and that part is going to come ahead. And we are going to learn coding in specific context of astronomy. We want to learn coding in connection with astronomy. So for that, we need some kind of numbers, right, from astronomy with which we can put it into our codes. So either some numbers or some equations we will need with which we want to do the coding, and so that we get some results out of it. So whatever I discussed just now were one or two of those. Even if you have not understood the entire astronomy context, don't worry. I hope you are there in the WhatsApp group, and we may have some more discussions. And even if you don't get very interested in position astronomy, because the details of it are highly mathematically complex, and if you'd want to start with simpler context, we can do those also. So if you have not understood the positional astronomy context fully, don't worry. See this video again later on and ask specific questions. If you ask specific questions, it will be easier to answer. Okay. So let's leave it at that for now. And then we want to move on to learning coding. And for this, what I'm taking help of, we had done a code camp, astronomy code camp, a few years ago. And from IIT Mumbai, there is this Fossey Python. Just check it out. In fact, they have many workshops, but usually I think they do for groups. So we can be one group and we can have more workshops from them. But they had the beginner Python workshop for us, for students who are here. And so I'm using some of that. So there is the talks, are these given by this Fossey group, and Professor Prabhu Ramanathan, I think. And he kind of, you know, takes you through wonderfully, and he stops for a while and asks you to actually do what he's doing. And in this context, I also want to tell you that this is where I asked you to have nThought Canopy with you, right? And that was because this was a few years ago, and that entire exercise was done through nThought Canopy. And the preliminaries there are going to be more terminal oriented. You open Canopy and you open kind of a Python terminal. So very basic, it starts, it gives you a lot of good handholding from very beginning. There are many, many Python learning tutorials online, and you should use all of them. But sometimes I find that for students, maybe the initial part, that getting started, becomes a bit of a problem, and suddenly somebody says, okay, you can easily do this. Here, these exercises go very step by step. And now some of you may not need some of the very beginning steps. If you are already using an online Jupyter notebook or some other format in which you are actually using a Jupyter notebook, you're doing some simple coding and so on, maybe you can ignore the very first preliminaries. However, the fact that they are taking one through step by step so nicely, I didn't want to lose them. So that is why I said nthought canopy. Those of you who have it, good, well and good. Those of you who don't have it, try and get an online Jupyter notebook and join in the exercises from the very first program, which says Hello World. Before that, there are some preliminaries. So the preliminaries are going to tell you, in fact, why Python and show you the power of Python and all of that. And I think it is good for us to go through those preliminaries. All right. So that is where we are. Actually, in the chat, I would like some of you to mention if you have already done some coding, what kind of coding, or maybe we will take it through a Google form. And but this one, these Python talks, they are assuming at least you have done somewhere some little bit of coding you have attempted. And but you know how to use maybe a computer and type on that. That's what actually Professor Ramanathan will take you through. So these are the videos that we had for that earlier one, and I'm using them. And I've written to them also as saying that we want to use it for a student group. So I hope that would be all right and useful for you. So let's get started.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to this session on Introductory Scientific Computing with Python. In this session, I will be talking to you about what Python is and why we should use Python. My name is Prabhu Ramachandran. I teach at the Department of Aerospace Engineering at IIT Bombay, and I've been using Python for close to 2 decades. Before we begin, I'd like to acknowledge the FOSSI group based out of IIT Bombay, and this project has been receiving funding through the National Mission on Education through ICT, and this program is being recorded under the FOSSI group. So the first question we look at is why Python? Specifically, why Python for scientific computing? And in this session, what I'd like to do is try to motivate you why we need to use Python. So when we as scientists do any research work, there are several things we need to look at. It's not always just pure computing that we're interested in. We often need to look at numeric and symbolic computation. And then when you're looking at data that you generate, you often need to explore and visualize that data. In addition, you also need to do high performance computing, parallel computing. And often your tasks aren't just restricted to these. You also want to create sometimes a user interface. You may want to create a website, or you may want to create a web-based application. For all of these, you need one powerful tool with which you can create applications, explore your data, do your numerics, do your high-performance computing, and a variety of other tasks that come up. So what we are looking for is, we are looking for a very general purpose tool that can help us do this. So why do we need Python? Well, so Python is a programming language that's very easy to read and learn. This makes it easy for people to quickly pick up the language. It provides you a very powerful interactive interpreter. This is similar to many other interactive systems. And for a lot of scientists, it's very important to be able to interactively explore your data. So the fact that it has a powerful interactive interpreter is a very, very important factor for scientists and engineers. Python is also very scalable. So you can not only write small little scripts to do things, you can also write full-fledged applications. And I'll show you quickly a few demonstrations of these. It's also very high level. So it's not a low level language like C or Fortran. It's high level, which means with a very few number of lines of code, you can achieve a lot. It also is modular, which means you can compose your programs using small elements, which is a good style of programming. And unlike certain languages, it doesn't force upon you programming paradigms. You can write it either procedural, object-oriented, or functional, and that's up to you. In addition to the basic features as a programming language, Python stands out simply because it has extensive libraries. And this facilitates rapid application development. So you can interface Python code to C++, C and Fortran codes. It's cross-platform and open source. And this makes it an extremely powerful tool that allows us to do all of those requirements that we talked about very easily and very conveniently. And it's completely free, so you can use it without any licensing. So let's look at the requirements. So if you look at numeric computation, typically this is what you have. So you have something like, you know, a terminal where you're typing code and you want to interactively explore your data. So for example, here are plots that are produced using Python. So there's a library called SciPy, which supports a variety of traditional numerical computing like linear algebra, numerical integration, Fourier transform, signal processing, special functions, statistics, optimization, image processing, ordinary differential equation solvers. And underneath, SciPy uses well-established libraries like LAPACK, QuadPACK, ODEPACK, FFTPACK. All of these are well-established libraries written either in Fortran or in C, and SciPy exports all of these into a Pythonic interface that's very easy to use. So this makes it very easy for scientists to do their numerical analysis. Now, it's not enough if you just generate numbers. You also want to be able to visualize these numbers. So if you look at this picture, we have a terminal here where we've typed out some code, and you can see that with like three lines of code, you're able to create a visualization like this. And this is a 3D interactive visualization. And all of this, the application itself is written in Python. The analysis is also doable using Python. So this shows you the breadth of things that you can do with Python. The same three-dimensional visualization tool also has a full-fledged application. As you can see here, you have a nice UI that you can click and use, and you have a visualization along with an embedded Python interactor. So all of this can be done with Python. This entire application is written with pure Python.
These videos were made into small segments and then uploaded into the studio. So I find that some of the text content is perhaps not coming out very clearly. However, let's just take this today as a kind of a for us to get started. And some of these details will be shared wherever there is clarity is lacking, will be shared in the WhatsApp group.
Now, as I do my research, for example, in aerospace engineering, I need to do a lot of computation. And this requires a lot of high-performance computing, and it's often in parallel. So a lot of my codes are all implemented in at a high level in Python. Underneath, they might be calling to C or C++ or Fortran libraries. But you can simulate things like this. So here's a dam of water here, and there's an obstacle that you see here. And the water essentially is flowing past this, as you can see in the second screenshot. So these kind of computations, again, can be performed through Python. So it's an extremely powerful tool that facilitates a lot of scientific computing. As I said, it's not all the time that you need to do computing. Sometimes you need to produce an application. So here, for example, is a screenshot of an application built using WXPython, which is a GUI toolkit. That's a graphical user interface toolkit. And you can see the kind of complicated UIs that you can build using Python. And again, this is written in Python. Here's another very, very simple example of code, which basically demonstrates these lines of code. 1, 2, 3, 4, about 6 lines of code. If you run this, you will get either this kind of a user interface if you're using Qt, or with WXPython, you'll get a user interface that looks like this. And this shows you that with a very small amount of code, you're actually able to create a user interface. This is again a very, very powerful feature that Python with a small amount of code lets you achieve a lot. Now, apart from desktop applications, you also want to create web applications. So there are many frameworks in Python that are called web frameworks. Basically, these allow you to host a web application on a web server. Django is one of these. It's probably the most popular of these. And with Django, you can build full-fledged websites as well as web applications. And that is also completely written in Python. Then again, let's step back. How about the language itself? So let's look at a small, simple example for the quicksort. It turns out that these 6 lines of code are essentially the quicksort implementation in Python. As you can see, quicksort is not a simple algorithm. But what you see here is, with these 6 lines, you succinctly capture the essence of a quicksort. And not only is it the essence, it's not pseudocode, it's real code. If you run this, it will actually work and help you sort elements using the quicksort algorithm. So as you can see, this code is very readable, very simple, and still very compact. It, you know, succinctly captures the intention of what you want to program. This is, again, a very important feature of Python. In fact, probably one of the most important features of Python, because if anybody writes the code in Python, usually, you will be able to read that code and follow what's going on. So, in this session, we will look at some preliminaries. These are important preliminaries for you to understand what we are going to be talking about in the subsequent sessions. So when we say Python, what do we mean? Typically, there are two things we are talking about. One is Python, the programming language. Just like C, programming language, is a Python programming language, which has a particular syntax. It has a set of libraries, so on and so forth. That is the Python language. The second that we talk about is what is called the Python interpreter. That is a program that understands Python and interprets the code that you type in or provide it in order to perform whatever tasks you want. So when we say Python, we either mean the programming language or we mean Python the interpreter. So when we say the interpreter, what do we mean? So if on a terminal you were to type Python, just P-Y-T-H-O-N, and you have Python installed, you will get something that looks like this. These three arrows that you see, you will see this is called a Python prompt. Alright, so what I want you to understand is this Python prompt, you can basically type Python code, which will be interpreted by this Python interpreter, which is just a program that is written by some programmers, which understands the Python language. Now you can use this Python interpreter to also run scripts. So supposing you create a little file called hello.py and you run it, it will have some code and it's going to perform some action. Now when you want to run it, you can simply say Python space script name, which is in this case hello.py, and it's going to do something. So the interpreter can be used to directly enter commands as well as to run scripts. Okay. Now Python by itself, the programming language, is a relatively simple language in the sense that it doesn't have too many programming constructs, which makes it easy to read and learn. But Python also has what is called a standard library, and this is built in. So if you just install Python, you will almost always have this standard library. And this standard library has a lot of important core functionality. And in the Python world, this is typically called batteries included, which basically means when you install Python, you get the standard library automatically. However, these basic standard library functionality that you have is usually not enough, and you need more packages. So there are many other packages that are available. For example, IPython, NumPy, SciPy, Matplotlib. These four you will be looking at over the next few sessions in great depth. There are many others like PyQt, Django, which I mentioned in the previous talk. Then there's something like Mayavi. All of these are other kind of packages. And there are more than a lakh packages. So if you go to a website called PyPy, the Python package infrastructure, you will see that there are close to a lakh of packages. So how do you install these packages is not always that easy. So if you want to just install the basic Python language, you can go to www.python.org/downloads and you will see something that looks like this. And it will say you can download this version of Python. Now what this gives you is just the Python language along with the standard library. It doesn't give you any of the extra packages. Installing those packages can be easy or difficult depending on the platform you're on.
All right. I think from this point onwards, it would be good to start doing some of the things which are being suggested. And so any of you who don't have, let me just see the comments also if there's any. All right, you are helping each other. That's very good. So if you don't have the Canopy, then whatever system you have, try and follow up. Many of these initially are terminal commands. So if you have Canopy, follow up exactly as he's saying. If not, try to find to do the same thing in some other format. Okay, so let's move on.
So on Linux, it is relatively easy to install these packages because they are typically packaged by the distributor. For example, if you're using any Debian derivative like Ubuntu, etc., you can just apt-get install certain Python packages and you'll get those packages automatically. You don't have to do anything extra. Similarly, with Red Hat, you can use Yum. However, this is not so easy on OS X and Windows. So this is where we have what's called Python distributions. What these distributions do is they allow you to install Python along with all various packages that are of interest in the community to install them easily. It allows you to install them easily. So one of the distributions, in fact the one that we will be using for this course, is called Canopy, nthought Canopy, and This is a very easy to use package. It provides a simple integrated development environment, which means it provides an editor as well as a Python console where you can type things, and it's a very easy interface. So if you are a beginner to Python, we strongly recommend that you try something like this, because it makes it much easier to install Python along with these additional packages that we require. The installer for this are available in Linux, OS X and Windows. It's free and it supports many of the packages that we'll be discussing in this course. Another very useful Python distribution is called Anaconda, and this is available through www.continuum.io/downloads. And again, they provide cross-platform installer on Linux, OS X and Windows. It provides again a free installer. They have an open source package manager called Conda. All of this is bundled together to make it very easy to install packages. For this course, however, we will be using Canopy for the very simple reason that it provides a very simple user interface. And it's also very easy for beginners. And because this is a beginning course, we want to provide you something that's very easy to start with. If you're an advanced user though, you can use anything you want. So there are no constraints on what you should use or should not use. But if you're a beginner, we strongly recommend that you follow using Canopy, because the material is designed to work very well with Canopy. To set up Canopy, just download it for your platform, install it and start it up. So before you start the subsequent lectures, please make sure you start up Canopy once. It will set up your environments for you. So in summary, in this session we looked at Python, the programming language, and showed you what the Python interpreter is in relation to this Python programming language. Then I talked to you about the Python standard library, which is usually bundled along with an installation of Python always. And then we looked at other Python packages that provide additional functionality. And then I talked to you about Python distributions. Notably, I talked to you about Canopy as well as Anaconda. In this session, we will introduce what we are going to study in the next several sessions. And then we look at IPython and how to plot with IPython. This material has been created by the FOSSI group based at IIT Bombay, and we are funded through the National Mission on Education through ICT from the MHRD, Government of India. Before we begin, there's a small checklist. We strongly recommend that you have Canopy installed, and we hope you have installed it and started Canopy once. We also require IPython, which is bundled with Canopy. So if you have Canopy installed, you don't have any problems. There are a few data files that are provided. Please make sure you have these files installed on your systems. This tutorial is intended towards engineering, mathematics and science researchers with a reasonable programming background. That is, we expect that you have done some programming at some point of time using some programming language. So the basic ideas about programming you are already aware of. You must also be familiar on how to use a computer and type on a computer. The goal for this workshop is that successful participants should be able to start using Python as a plotting and computational tool. You will be able to use the basic libraries and tools for scientific computing with Python. That's the goal of this course. So let us first begin. This session is going to be entirely interactive, as will be many of the subsequent sessions. So we strongly encourage that you type along and follow along with whatever is shown on the slides. So our first task is to start up IPython. To do this, you first need to start up a terminal. And there's a reason we are doing this. We want to show you how you can use Python from even just a terminal. To start a terminal on Canopy, you can go to the Tools menu and you will see something called the Canopy Command Prompt. So let us do this. So if you go to Canopy, go to the Tools menu on the top, click on it, and then you will see a Canopy terminal here. Click on this and you should see a terminal popping up. This terminal has Python available and allows you to type Python and do all of your Python related tasks. Now, once you get on this terminal, we want you to type the following code: IPython space minus minus pylab. You do not have to type the dollar. Please note that this dollar sign we will always show to denote the terminal prompt. So for example, if we go here, notice that there is a dollar here. This dollar signifies that the prompt, that is the command prompt of your terminal, in which you are supposed to enter any commands. Now on Windows, you may not see a dollar, you may see some other symbol, but in our slides, we were always going to refer to the dollar sign as this prompt. So whenever you see the dollar sign, it suggests that you must type in the terminal. So let us first type start IPython space minus minus pylab. Type this and hit enter. Please note, you must type all the characters exactly. Any spelling mistakes, your terminal will not tolerate, you will get an error. So make sure you type it as IPython space minus minus or hyphen hyphen pylab. Hit enter, and now you should see something that looks like this. Okay, so this prompt you see here on the left, IN, that I am highlighting here, IN bracket 1, that is called the IPython prompt. Whenever you see an IN 1 colon, this is called an IPython prompt. So in our slides, we will be showing you IN colon, that means you have to type that code inside this IPython prompt.
All right. I see the comments also that the quality of the visual. That's because this was kind of made in, it was just original, was simply too high resolution to be uploaded into the studio. So I'm going to try to screen share and maybe we'll backtrack a little and redo that. However, then I'll get limited by my bandwidth, network bandwidth here. And also when I do that, I am not able to see your comments. So if there is any serious problem with this, someone will have to message me on WhatsApp, then I will be able to look at it. So that's what I'm going to try to do now. Screen share, we'll backtrack a little and look at this lecture. Audio also needs to be shared, right? I think I will have to do entire screen with audio. Only the problem will share. So let me do that.
Command prompt. So let us do this. So if you go to Canopy, go to the tools menu on the top, click on it, and then you will see a Canopy terminal here. Click on this, and you should see a terminal popping up. This terminal has Python available and allows you to type Python and do all of your Python related tasks. Now, once you get on this terminal, we want you to type the following code, IPython space minus minus pylab. You do not have to type the dollar. Please note that this dollar sign we will always show to denote the terminal prompt. So for example, if we go here, notice that there is a dollar here. This dollar signifies that the prompt, that is the command prompt of your terminal, in which you are supposed to enter any commands. Now on Windows, you may not see a dollar, you may see some other symbol, but in our slides, we were always going to refer to the dollar sign as this prompt. So whenever you see the dollar sign, it suggests that you must type in the terminal. So let us first type start IPython space minus minus pylab. Type this and hit enter. Please note, you must type all the characters exactly. Any spelling mistakes, your terminal will not tolerate, you will get an error. So make sure you type it as IPython space minus minus or hyphen hyphen pylab. Hit enter. And now you should see something that looks like this. Okay, so this prompt you see here on the left, IN, that I am highlighting here, IN bracket 1, that is called the IPython prompt. Whenever you see an IN 1 colon, this is called an IPython prompt. So in our slides, we will be showing you IN colon, that means you have to type that code inside this IPython. To summarize, the dollar, wherever you see a dollar, that means type on the terminal. Wherever you see a IN, that means this is the IPython prompt, and you can type the Python code inside here. Now let us write our first hello world program in Python. So please type the following code: print open parenthesis open quote hello world close quote close parenthesis. Remember, you should type this on the IPython command prompt, that is where you see this IN square bracket 1 colon. When you type this, you should see this output printed, hello world. Please type this right now. Have you finished typing this? Have you all finished typing this? Okay, so that is your first hello world program in Python. Now the most important thing that you must learn when you get into an interpreter is how to exit from this IPython so that you can get back to typing other things on your terminal. To exit, you can press Control D. That is the Control key and the D key together on the keyboard. Don't type CTRLD and all of that. You just press Control, the Control character on your keyboard, and the D key together. So let us try this. We do Control D. Now you will be given a prompt saying, do you really want to exit? Notice that the Y is within square brackets, suggesting that it is the default. So if you just press enter now, it will exit. Otherwise you can press Y, it will also exit. But if you press N or any other key, it will not exit. So let us exit, Control D, enter. And now you get back to the terminal prompt. Notice that the dollar is there again. This is the terminal prompt. So to start IPython again, you can do IPython minus minus pylab, enter, and you will come back to IPython. So what is this IPython? I have only talked to you about Python so far. What is IPython? So IPython is an enhanced Python interpreter. It is also a Python library. It is not part of the standard library, so it must be installed separately. And Canopy, Anaconda, and all of these Python distributions usually provide it conveniently. So we are using IPython because it provides a lot of convenient functionality that is extremely useful for both beginners as well as advanced users. As a result, we are asking IPython. Now let us see how we can break out of loops. This is important to learn early on, because if you get stuck at some point, you should know what to do. So please type the following code. While you are doing it, please note the following. What we are doing is, we are doing a while, infinite while loop, while true, print hello world. So what this should do is it will keep printing hello world on and on. So you have to exit this loop. The only way to exit it is to press Control and C keys together. Now when you are typing this code, please remember that the print line after the while line has to be indented 4 spaces to the right. This will be automatically there in your IPython command prompts. It will automatically indent the code for you. But after you type print hello world, you must type a new line and then another new line to get the for loop running. So these 3 dots and the colon suggest that this is what is called a continuation prompt, which means the code is not complete. It is expecting you to type something more. Alright, so let us try this. Please type this code. While true, print hello world. Please remember that the colon after true is very important. It cannot be semicolon, it must be colon. Please type this code. To exit from this infinite loop, press Control and C keys together simultaneously. So do you get an infinite loop? All right, I'll give you some more time to type. So let us try this. I hit return. I must hit return once again, as you saw in the slides. This is what ensures that the loop is complete now. Now, world many times. So, press Control C and it will exit. Don't worry, you are going to see some messages like this. This is simply saying that there was a keyboard interrupt received and IPython is ready to receive your next command. Don't worry, there is no error at this point. This is what you get. So, once again, what we did was we typed while true, we indented the print line 4 spaces to the right. We had to hit enter. One more time we hit enter, then the hello world keeps printing. To get out of this infinite loop, we press Control C. That is Control key and C keys together. This will give you some keyboard interrupt. Don't worry about it. Nothing has gone bad. Now we have a little exercise. Exit the IPython interpreter. Close your terminal. Restart the terminal using the Canopy Tools menu. And then restart IPython using IPython --. Please do this. I give you 2 minutes to do this.
Oops, I'm sorry.
So once again, please exit the IPython interpreter, close the terminal, restart the terminal using the Canopy Tools menu, restart IPython using IPython --. Are you all done? Okay. So once again, I will remind you that this dollar sign suggests that you must type this command on the terminal, not inside IPython. So let us do this exercise. We first exit IPython, close the terminal, go to Canopy, go to the Tools menu, click on Canopy Terminal. Then we simply type IPython --pylab. Now we are back at the IPython prompt. All right, let us now start plotting. Let us start making some interesting plots using IPython. Now, before we begin, for this first session alone, we strongly recommend that you do not experiment. Please follow along and type everything that I am asking you to type. Please remember that the case of what you type matters. So make sure if it is lowercase, it should be lowercase. If it is uppercase, it should be uppercase. Every character you type matters, the spelling matters. So please pay attention and make sure you type properly. And please don't experiment. Don't close your terminal unless I tell you to close the terminal. Fine. Let us start drawing plots. Please type the following. These two lines that you see in, please type these two lines of code. Once again, please remember the spelling matters. So type x is equal to linspace, linspace, open parenthesis 0, comma 2 star pi, comma 50, close parenthesis, and then hit new line, return. And then you type the second line, plot x, comma sine of x. Are you all done? Do you have your first plot? So your plot should look like what you see here. You see a nice sinusoidal plot. It should look like what is shown on this slide here. Okay, so that's your first plot with Python. Now let us walk through what you have typed. The first line that you had said x is equal to linspace. Then you gave it three numbers: the starting point, the stopping point, and the number of values. So the starting point was 0, the stop was 2 into pi, and there were 50 values. So what this does is, this creates 50 evenly spaced points in the interval, start and stop, including the start and the stop. The first value will be 0, the last value will be 2 into pi. So to see this in action, on your interpreter, please type these two, x square bracket 0, return, and then x square bracket 49, and see what the values you get. I hope you have finished typing this. So if you notice, x square bracket 0 will give you 0.0, which was the starting value that you
had. Here?
And x 49 is the stopping value. So clearly you can see that the indices in Python start from 0 and go to the number of elements minus 1, which is 49 in this case, because we had asked for 50 values. The next line that we had was plot. You gave it x and y. In this case, y was sine of x. Now, what this did was it plotted the sine values for each of those values of x. And it uses some default line style and color. In this case, that was a solid line with a blue color. That's what you got. Okay, let us move on. Once again, I remind you, please do not close the plot windows or IPython. For the first session, please do not experiment. Don't type all kinds of things at this stage, because we want you to get started with the first session. After the first session, you will be able to experiment and do whatever you want. Please follow along and type everything that I ask you to type. And then once again, the case matters, the spelling matters. Every character you type matters. Okay, please pay attention. Let us move on with plotting. So please type the following two commands, x label and y label. I hope you have finished typing this. So the first command, x label, notice that it has something that looks like a string inside it. And notice that on the plot that you get, you will see that the x is now labeled with the character x. Similarly, the y label gives you a label on the y axis called sine of x. And notice that you have given x label as within quotes x and y label within quotes sine of x. Anything within quotes is called a string in Python. So you give it any string and it will put that string as the labels. Now that you have typed this, let us move on. Let us do a little more. So the first thing that you need to understand is, if you want to clear an existing plot, you must type CLF. So I'll explain this and then you can start typing. When you do CLF, it actually clears the entire plot area. So if you try this command, you will see that your screen, your plot window becomes blank. Once again, don't close the plot window yet. We have many things to do. So first type CLF. Notice that the plot area has been cleared. And then type the remaining four commands that you see below. These four commands are a recap of whatever you had already typed, but we want you to type this. Please go ahead and type these commands. And we'll wait for you. So CLF, open close bracket, will clear the plot area. Please notice that and then type the subsequent commands. Have you finished typing? So once again, CLF clears the plot area, and the subsequent commands are commands that you have already seen. All we have done here is we have created y, which is now going to be an array of 50 elements from 0 to 2 pi. We plot y and sine 2y, not sine of x, like x and sine of x. Now it's y and sine 2y, and we have labeled it as such. X label is y, and y label is sine 2y. Again, very simple from whatever we had seen before. Now, when you are doing this typing, you will notice that there is a lot to type. We strongly recommend that you use IPython's tab completion capability. So whenever you type a command, you can press the tab key. So in this slide, if you see PL tab, this doesn't mean you have to type less than TAB greater than. Instead, you should be typing the tab key. This is the key that is on top of the caps lock, usually next to the Q key if you have a QWERTY keyboard. So let us demonstrate this. So if I say PL tab, notice that it gives me several possible completions, place, plot, plot file, PLT, so on and so forth. If I type one more character and hit tab, it will complete it to plot. So supposing I just want plot, now you can continue to type whatever you want. Similarly, if you type LIN tab, it will give you LINS tab, will give you linspace. So basically, be comfortable using the tab key. Once again, PL tab, press the tab key, which is above the caps lock. Now, this is a very convenient command, that is to do tab completion, so that you don't have to type everything. It will automatically complete it for you. In addition, IPython also stores all of typing history. So if you have already typed sine x comma sine of x, you don't have to type it again. What you can do is you can type up arrow to go to previous commands. You can type left arrow, right arrow to move and edit whatever previous command you have typed. For example, if I had typed x is linspace, I get this plot. Now, if I do say CLF, like what you have done, and now if I hit up arrow, it shows me CLF, another up arrow, it shows me plot, another up arrow, it gives me linspace. Now, supposing I want to change this to Y, I can use the arrow keys, edit the backspace, type Y, and I finish typing the next command that you had. So, this way you can easily go navigate up your history and get previous commands in addition to doing the tab combination. Now, the other useful thing is, supposing you want to recall the last time you typed linspace. If you type L-I-N up arrow, it will show me the last time I typed starting with linspace. So it will only look for the starting characters. So let us say you want to go back and recall your plot command. You do PL up arrow, it will immediately recall the last command you typed starting with PL. Now, if you don't want this command, unfortunately, you are going to have to remove it and edit it. So you can edit it and remove it. Now, for example, if I want to do x equal to, if I hit up arrow, it will immediately bring me to x is equal to linspace. And now if I hit return, I can execute this command. So this feature of history is extremely useful that you should learn and you should keep using going forward. So whenever I ask you to type something, feel free to use tab completion and use your history. Once again, tab key completes, up arrow, down arrow will go through your history, left, right you can move and edit, and then you can type some text and press up arrow, it will find the previous command starting with that. There are some more things you can do. I am going to leave these in the slide, so we are not going to spend more time on this, but you can press certain keys. For example, if you press Ctrl R and start typing, it will search through your history. Similarly, Ctrl A will go to the start of the line, Control E goes to the end of the line, and Control K will kill from the current location of the cursor to the end of the line. You need not use these. Please feel free to use this as you see fit. Okay, let us move on and do a little more decoration to our plots. Please type the following two lines, title and legend. Once again, I hope you have not closed your IPython and plot windows. This is the reason I mentioned, please do not close any of your windows for this particular session. At the end of this, you will see your plot should look like what we have on the screen here. I hope you have finished typing this. So the first line title basically produces this title you see here, and the second line actually produces this legend. Notice that again it's very important that you type this as seen on the screen here. There's a square bracket here and it ends with a square bracket, otherwise you're not going to get the correct answer. What this is actually a list, and we'll see more about lists in the subsequent session. So in this case we have a single legend for the sine 2y plot. Now, by default, the legend is placed at some convenient location on the screen. Supposing you don't want it at the default location, but you want to place it somewhere else, you can try the following. Please type this legend and supply this additional argument. Once again, you can use the history, so you can press up arrow to go back to your previous command, edit it, add this code here. Remember, this is a comma here. So, comma, LOC equal to center. Once you do this, you will see that the legend is no longer placed here on the top right, but it now has come to the center. So there are many other possible arguments for LOC. Notice that this is a string. Remember that anything within quotes is a string. So LOC in this case is center. You could also have used best, which is the default, or right, or left, or center. There are many others. We will explore these later. But the thing I want you to remember is you can provide additional command line arguments to these functions to do different things. Many functions are like this. You can give them additional arguments in order to do different things. Once again, do not close the plot windows or IPython. Please don't experiment for this session alone. Please follow along and type everything. Everything you type matters, as you have already noticed. If you make any single mistake, you will get some error or an error message. Don't worry, please continue typing and type as you see on the screen. Okay, so now let us see how we can show our plots even better. So far we only use the default colors. Please type the following code. When you type the first line, plot y comma cos y, notice that you are giving it an additional string called r. When you type this, you will see a red color plot overlaid on your existing sine 2y plot. Please make a note of this before you type the subsequent two lines. What I have typed here is a comment. This hash mark suggests it's a comment. It's in red. So, don't pay attention to that. I don't want you to type this see a red plot. I only want you to type plot y cos y r. You will immediately see that there's a red plot. Subsequently, you type clf and then plot y sine y g line with 2. Please make sure you type clf, otherwise you will have multiple plots on the same plot. I want you to clear the clf, will clear the area, so you will have a plot that looks like this. Once again, please make sure you type carefully, paying attention to every character and every letter. So now you will notice that in the third line, plot y sine y g, we had an additional argument just like LOC equal to center, we say line width equal to 2. Notice that the line width that you see will be much thicker. So for this plot, you will see a line width of 2. This is how you specify additional parameters to configure your plot. Let us now move on to doing some simple text annotation. Please type this one line. Annotate local max xy equal to bracket 1.5 comma 1 close bracket. Please type this. When you type this, you will notice that there is a little piece of text local max that is placed at the xy location of 1.5 comma 1. So this is a plot of a sine. So where is the local maximum of sine? It should actually be at pi by 2, at the value of the y location will be 1. So in this case, we have approximated it to 1.5 comma 1. So what happens is this local max text is placed at the bottom left coordinate of this local max text box will be at exactly 1.5 comma 1. What this allows us to do is to annotate different parts of your text, of your plots, in a very nice way. What this allows you to do is annotate your plots in a nice way and add some text to annotate your plots. Now that we know how to create a plot and how to annotate it and how to specify various about this plot, we need to be able to save it. Because we want to make a publication or you want to produce it in a report, we must save this plot. So what you do is you type this command, save fig, and give it the name of the file. Please type this command, save fig. In this case, the file is saved into a PNG file called sin.png. So now if you go to your file browser on your operating system, this file will be saved inside the current directory in which Python is running currently. Alright? So this is probably your home directory. This file will be located there. Open a browser, make sure your file browser and make sure that you are able to see this file. Double click the file and you should see a sine plot which looks exactly like your figure plot. Now once you are done with saving this figure, you can close that entire plot window by typing the command close, C-L-O-S-E. Please type that command. Your plot window will disappear. Okay, now that you have saved a figure, I want you to note that if you change the extension, so if you make it from sine.png, if you use sine.pdf or sine.svg, you would actually get it in a different file format. In this case, the library we are using is called matplotlib. Matplotlib will automatically determine what extension you are using and save it to an appropriate file format. Therefore, all your plots you can save in a variety of different supported formats using savefig. The same command, just change the name of the file. One more point to note, supposing you want to save this file to a different directory, you must enter the full path to that directory or a relative path to that directory. So if you have a subdirectory inside which you want to put it, you can simply say subdirectory slash sine.png, it will be saved into that subdirectory. Essentially, this is a file name that to supply. So with this, you now know how to create plots, annotate plots, save them, and close your plot window. So another point to note is that supposing you close this window, save fig will not give you any plot. So any save fig command you run must be done before you close the plot. So if you wanted to change the file name, for example, once you have closed the plot, you'll have to remake the entire plot and then save it again. Otherwise, you have to do the change of the file name through your file browser. So let us move on and recap what we have done so far. So far we saw linspace, start, end, number. You remember we have typed this many times. It includes the starting value and the ending value and gives you this many number of values in between. The next is plot, which is you use to plot, and it also supports additional arguments which you have seen. And then we saw CLF. Then we annotated the plot using xlabel, ylabel, title, legend and annotate. Finally, we saved our figure using the savefig command, and we saw that it supports various file formats. We saved it with the PNG format. And then we finally looked at close. The close command will close your window. We have now seen single plots. How do you make multiple plots? Please type the following code. Once again, remember to use history and tab completion. The first line you have already typed. So use up arrow or type y space equal to up arrow and it will give you that. I hope you have finished typing this. This is all old commands you have already done. I'll still wait for you for a couple of minutes to finish typing this. You don't need to type this hash note how we made two legends. That is a note for you to keep in mind. All of these commands you have seen before. The only difference is in the legend we now have two things. We have a string called sin y, comma, and cos y, another string. These are all inside a list. So now we have two plots and you have two legends. Notice how you made two legends. This is important for you to remember. The thing to notice with this plot is that the plots are overlaid, which means you see both the sin y as well as the cos together on the same plot. So notice that you need to type this legend command very carefully. Any mistakes you make here will mean you will not get two legends. Please make sure you type this very carefully. Again, I will repeat, legend, open parenthesis, open square bracket, sin y as a string, comma, another string, cos y, and close square parenthesis, enter. Once you do this, you will see two legends. So let us move on. Now how do we plot separate figures? So supposing you want to make two plots, one with one plot, another with a different plot, and you want to save them, you use what is called the figure command. Please type this code that you see on the screen. Again, reminder, use tab and the up arrow key. Please do not experiment. Don't close your windows. Don't activate your windows with the mouse either. Just type this code as it is given here in your IPython session. I'd like to point out one thing. So each time you type some of these commands like plot, you will notice that it says something out, something, something. It's not an error. Don't worry about it. Just continue typing. That is actually something that that function is returning. So don't get alarmed by it. It's not an error. Python will tell you explicitly if it sees an error. Don't worry about anything that it is returning and giving you back. Just type this as you see. So what we'll see is, when you do CLF, what does it do? It will clear your screen area. Then when you do figure 1, you will get a blank figure. When you do plot y, sine y, you will see a sine y in one plot. When you do figure 2, you will get another blank window in which you are plotting cos y. Now when you do save fig, this figure command is only associated with the second figure. So it will actually save cosine.png. You can check your file browser and you will find this file. Then if you want to switch back to the figure 1, you just say figure 1. So you must remember which figure you have typed, either 1 or 2. And by typing figure, that number, it will go to that particular number. So now you go to figure 1, you title it with sine y, and then you save the figure to sine.png. Then when you hit close, it will close figure 1. Then you hit close again, it will close figure 2. So what you have seen here is that this figure command allows you to create a new window and also allows you to move between existing figure windows that you have already created. One thing to remember when you are making this figures and figure commands is, if you actually use the mouse and click on one of those figures, it will actually change the active figure. So this is ideal when you want to automatically generate, say, 2 plots. But if you are going to interactively go and click on a figure, please make sure that the current figure is activated by selecting the appropriate figure. So you have to say figure 1 or figure 2. This is how you plot separate figures. Let us move on. Now, you have already made several plots. But sometimes you want to know what is the axis length that the plot has been made with. To find this, please type these following commands. Once again, type it very carefully. Xmin, xmax equal to xlim. Square bracket, open, close. Type each of these 3 lines. Notice once again, typing xmin comma xmax equal to xlim, which means xlim is actually returning 2 quantities, minimum value, maximum value along the x. Ylim is returning 2 quantities, minimum value of y, maximum value of y. And when you print it, you will again see whatever value that you had, probably 0 to 1 is what you will see. Now supposing you want to set the axis limits, it's very simple. You just call xlim with the 2 arguments, xlim, xmin, comma, 2 into pi. In this case, we want to set the limits of the x-axis to 0 to 2 pi. Please type these 2 lines, xlim and ylim. Have you finished typing? I'll wait for a little bit. Again, make sure you type it very carefully. Xlim, xmin, comma, 2 star pi. Ymin, minus 0.2, ymax, plus 0.2. So what does this do? If you notice your plot, you'll see that the limits of the x-axis are from 0 to 2 pi. But the limits of the y-axis will be from minus 0.2 to 1.2. So this is how you can set the limits of your plot. This is very convenient when you want to size your plot and appropriately limit the plot dimensions. This is what you will end up with. Supposing you had a plot you had made, if you set the x-axis limit, it has increased the y-limit by 0.2 and set the x-axis limit from 0 to 2 pi. there is one important thing that you must all learn how to use, which is how to look up documentation in the IPython console. So in IPython, supposing you want to learn more about this plot function, we have used it many times, but let's say we want to see the documentation of this, you can simply type plot question mark in the IPython console and you will get information on plot. Now when you type plot question mark enter, it will give you the documentation, but you can browse this using your arrow keys to go up and down. But if you want to quit from this text browser for your help, you must press Q. So let us look at this. Plot question mark enter. Now notice that it has given me a lot of information about plot. So I can use the arrow go up and down and notice that it has a lot of information, how to type various things, so on and so forth. You can use the space key to move by an entire page down. You will also see many, many examples of various things you can do with this. Use the up arrow, down arrow, but remember, you will see this colon on the left here. You have to quit from this, so press Q. Now you will get back your IPython prompt. Again, to repeat, plot, again, up arrow gives me plot, question mark. Return gives me the help. Q will quit from this help. Use the arrow keys to scroll the docs. Now, this is an extremely powerful feature. You have learnt about 10 different functions in this session. For each of these, you can easily do question mark and learn how to use this command better. What are the various options? How to use it? All of those will be available in this help document. Please make sure you try to use this more and more as you go along learning Python. Now, sometimes you also may want to see what is the source code of that function that you have. This is also easy to do. You just need to type plot double question mark return. In this case, it shows me some Python code. At this point, you may not understand what it is. But again, if you get a pager, which means if you get more than one screen, you will have to press Q to exit to get back to the IPython prompt. But basically, the double question mark allows you to look at the source code for plot. Sometimes it will make sense, sometimes you may not be able to understand it too much, but it is useful for us to be able to look at source code when we are doing any of our IPython work. Once again, plot question mark will give you documentation, plot double question mark will give you the source. More often than not, you will be using the documentation a lot. We now leave you with a review problem. We want you to plot the following. We want you to plot x versus x, of course. Plot x versus minus x versus x, sine x versus x, and x sine x, that is x into sine x, between the range minus 5 pi to plus 5 pi. Now remember, in our original example, we used 50 points. In this case, you will have to use more points. So use, say, 500 points. And add a legend to this, annotate the origin, set the x-axis limits to the range of x, that is minus 5 pi to 5 pi. Similarly, set the y-axis range to minus 5 pi to plus 5 pi. You should see a plot that looks like this. Notice, once again, we added a legend, we add an origin here, and the origin at 0, 0. And also notice the colors. We want to make sure that you are able to produce this plot exactly as it is seen. That is, the straight lines are blue, sine x is in green. But notice that the sine x line is slightly thicker than the straight line. And then the x sine x red line is even thicker than the green line. I want you to be able to reproduce this plot with everything you know. We have taught you all of the code to do this. Please take 5 minutes to try to solve this exercise problem. If you have run out of time, please do this as homework, but be ready with a plot that looks like this. Thank you.
Yes. So that brings us to the end of today's discussions. And I hope everyone could hear throughout. And if there are any problems, etc., also now I'll be sharing one link for this has already been in the WhatsApp group. I hope everyone is in the WhatsApp group. And so this allows you to learn coding directly in an online Jupyter notebook. So that link has been shared. It may not be there for long, so just take the link if you have not done it. And okay, it's been removed. So I can't share links here, but it's been shared in the WhatsApp group. And so we will be meeting actually now online like this, perhaps only next Tuesday or so. But meanwhile, in the WhatsApp group, we'll have discussions. We will try and see everyone is able to finish this particular homework exercise. And then we will move forward. Meanwhile, any other possibilities of explorations, all of those will be discussed in the WhatsApp group. So we will end this today. And thank you all for participating. And I hope everyone has been going along with the instructions. And if we have lagging behind, as I am, I was not able to follow through fully, we will catch up and meet in the WhatsApp group. Thank you.